Fill her up.
You're listening to the Gas Digital Network.
Good afternoon, Michael Malice here. Let that be your welcome for the next hour. We have with us someone who I have called in print and in public many times a real hero of liberty, Cody Wilson. You are the director of Defense Distributed. You're the man behind Ghost Guns. And I'm ecstatic because we're recording this here at your headquarters.
Welcome to Defense Distributed, Austin, Texas.
Let that be my welcome. So, let's just get the stuff that people want to talk about quickly out of the way. You got arrested not that long ago. You paid a girl to sleep with her. Turned out she was underage. They tried to railroad you. You got shit. You went on the lam, came back. What's the status of that case?
You know, even I would dispute even the facts.
There, okay, please. Right. Please do.
You know, you can call me like delusional or whatever, but I would say I was in a lifestyle, like the sugar daddy lifestyle, right? And I'd been there for many years, so. In my mind, like things it wasn't a quid pro quo, it wasn't prostitution. In fact, you know, the discussion of money was never really there, actually, right? Like that's just my kind of perverse generosity after like a date, you could say.
Okay.
But look, it is what it is. Now, tellingly, I guess prostitution charges were never brought up or never involved. It was always just about sex with a minor, you know, which is a big no-no.
Yeah.
Anywhere, of course. And so like the entire case revolved around, her age and what we knew, what we didn't know. And it just turns out that it wasn't really a strong case, to be made by the prosecution. Like I've heard tons of times that, well, how did he ever get back? How is he not, you know, 40 years in jail or something? Look, you know, she approached me, the facts show it. She lied about her age. And, you know, like I have as few hard feelings as I can have about the situation, but it was a politically convenient prosecution.
Right.
And, you know, I took responsibility and still take that responsibility, but I'm back at work doing what I do.
Here's what I don't understand. You and I both perfectly are aware of the nature of the state. And you look at people like Ross Ulbricht, you look at people like Al Capone. If they want to get rid of you, they will take any justification to do so. It's kind of like, let's find him. The idea that some kind of prosecutor can't ex post facto find some way to find some law to put some way for life. You know, I think that happens very frequently, especially for people who are poor, perhaps in this country. Was that your thinking? How did you find out that, you know, they were going to get you, and how'd you make your escape plan?
Well, it was a busy month. I mean, that was August of 2018, and I was already kind of, you know, enemy number one in the press at that point. We were getting sued by like half the country and lots of different venues in federal court. So I didn't really see this coming, but I did. Like I was in contact with the girl's friend, and the girl's friend just happened, like I hadn't heard from the girl for a few days, and the girl's friend just happened to tell me, she's like, hey, the police got her phone. And I forget what else she told me beyond that, but she was like, if you hear from her again, it's probably the cops.
Okay.
And I believe that, you know, I didn't think she'd be lying to me about that. And immediately I got in touch with counsel. Like I always have attorneys, right, for everything, white collar crime, like, I mean, you name it. And I was like, you know, how credible is this? Do we have contacts with the DA? What can we do? I was hoping that we could back channel a conversation, you know, negotiate, I don't know, me turning myself in or pleading or whatever, because I just assumed, because of how high profile I was at the time, they'd probably go for some type of equally high profile.
Of course. Make an example of you.
And you can say that I made that easier to do by not coming back to Austin. But I was in California at the time. I was scheduled like in a few weeks to speak at the Institute of Crypto-Anarchy in Prague. And so I just decided to stay international while I was told that this investigation was ongoing. And then I was also told that investigations like this can sometimes last months. So my plan was to just stay scarce. You know, I saw in the news and stuff, I was called a fugitive and that kind of stuff. That's just not the case. It doesn't
wow.
work that way.
Okay.
Like if they issue a warrant for your arrest or whatever, it immediately cancels everything. You can't flee, especially internationally if there's a warrant out for you. So I don't know what the internals were. It didn't really come out in discovery, but just seemed that they wanted to pocket warrant me. They didn't want to investigate me. They didn't want to ask me questions yeah. about it. They were just getting ready to kind of ice me. And they went really quick. And in fact, so quick that it turns out you know, I guess that was to my advantage because they didn't end up building a very good case because they didn't end up having a very good case. And so when we got back here for the next year, we were able to negotiate a probation.
Were you surprised that you were able to not have your entire life destroyed?
I guess it just depends on what you mean.
That you didn't end up like Ross Ulbricht?
Well, sure. I mean, in one sense, I would say in one sense, my life has been forfeit for like a long time anyway.
Okay.
I mean, just the fact that, you know, in my distorted point of view back in that time, I was thinking the lifestyle I had was the safest lifestyle in this Capone context. It's like, look, I know the people that I had relationships with, I've known them for a while. We know exactly what we expect of each other. I have no reason to expect to be Me Too'd or Assange'd or something. This, you know, in my mind, they weren't random hookups. There was plenty of ongoing conversation and relationships being developed. But I can see how delusional that is now. I don't know. I just I wasn't thinking straight. My mind was always on, well, you know, they'll get me with taxes or they'll get me with gun crime. Because what we do is we practice in so many gray areas with export law and with the GCA and the NFA. You know, it's always the bust that you don't see coming. So.
I mean, but that, at what point were you like, holy crap, I'm not going to be in jail for the rest of my life?
Oh, did I realize I wasn't getting Ross Ulbricht? Sorry. I guess what I'm trying to say is I had already assumed my life was forfeit, and I think that's the right
way to practice. Oh, I see.
Okay. Right? I had already cast myself in this posthumous light for years because I've been told, I mean, how many times has this happened to me where a lawyer or someone has told me my life is over? Probably more than you would guess. And this began when I was in law school when the Obama administration accused me of violating the ITAR. You know, one violation, $10 million, 20 years in jail, you know, and I was looking at stacked violations. And I've had criminal attorneys and I've done counsel's memos on every decision we've taken as a corporation for so many years and felt that sinking feeling about like when we launched Ghost Gunner, when we, you know, been attacked by so many states. And even while this was going on with the girl, I had this contempt of court proceeding happening in New Jersey simultaneously. I mean, it was like, you get this sense that like somebody's gonna do you, gonna put you in jail. And I suppose that lends itself to a certain recklessness, but at the same time, I had been doing what I've been doing for so many years. I don't know. I can say one, I wasn't thinking clearly, but two, I'd also completed the, what do you call it? It's one of these self-affirming philosophies or, hold on, let me think about this.
God give me the strength to control what I can.
Like a self-fulfilling prophecy, right? Like okay. Where you're like, you're in an attitude of recklessness because like you've already overextended yourself for so many years and
you know. Living on borrowed time.
Yeah. So I guess like the reason that this happened is because I had kind of already been in that headspace for so long and just assumed normal relationships weren't any safer anyway.
Okay.
Anyway. To finally answer your question, I hope you do edit this because I'm just like going on and on.
You're fine.
To finally answer your question, I don't know. I think once, you know, I knew the facts the whole time myself. So I just didn't really see a situation where they actually wanted to put me away for a ton of time. I mean, the intent isn't there. And they knew I was willing to fight it, not just on the facts, but on the law itself. The law in Texas on these questions is strict liability. And look, I'm willing to change that. You know, I don't want to be the advocate for that state of affairs, but strict liability crimes, especially in instances like this, the social media and swiping culture and hookup culture and stuff, it shouldn't defend bad faith behavior of the party.
I mean, you went in there thinking you were told explicitly she's of age.
I know everyone says that. That's just what the facts were. And if the facts were otherwise, I wouldn't be talking to you.
What's Ghislaine Maxwell like in real life?
You know, she's very sweet.
That accent.
The thing about her, you know, when I examine her face or something, not that I've done that in person, but you get this, even though she's been at this for like 20, 30 years, you get this deer in the headlights look, like people, and I think that's what's fascinating about her. She's more interesting than Epstein in a way because it's like, was she carried into this? Did she do this to win the heart of Epstein and just kind of didn't realize her own decadence after a certain amount? Or is she part of like a satanic, you know, cabal, which is like invested in power? And you can read all of that on her face. I don't know. I think there's something bizarre about her that almost makes her a sympathetic figure.
She must be the best saleswoman in history. Because first of all, getting any teenage girl to do anything is a nightmare. Second of all, you have to sit down as an old lady and tell this girl that sleeping with Jeffrey Epstein is in her best interest. You've got to have some crazy amount of game.
Well, you know, this is the stuff that got like Stallman canceled. You know about this?
No.
Richard Stallman got kicked out of MIT finally for, you know, offering his opinions about things like this, where he's like, well, clearly some of these victims were, you know, they volunteered themselves, you know. You can't claim that they were pure victims. So is it really Ghislaine's salesmanship, or is it the fact that everybody wants to be in New York? Is it the fact that this is proximate to model culture in the first place?
Oh, yeah, that's a good point.
They're already putting you up in apartments anyway. They're already basically trafficking you around, and you're a willing object in that system of objects. I'm not surprised to learn people like Heidi Klum were involved in this network, you know, and that the proximate causes and relationships in this run right through the fashion industry, run right through people's desire to make it in New York and to be made, and who's consuming who, you know? But of course, I have to say Epstein and Ghislaine represent what can only be described as a machine of evil.
Do you think he killed himself?
I mean, how can I know? I digested everything that you guys did. I mean, we've only seen the same stuff.
Here was the question I had on Rogan.
Yeah.
There was no perp walk.
They didn't perp walk Epstein. So what, you think he's sitting in Tel Aviv right now or something?
There's no perp walk. There's no footage of him in jail. I'm not saying he's sitting in Tel Aviv. I'm saying I don't have an explanation for that, even the bad explanation.
I thought I saw pictures of his body getting wheeled into
an
ambulance and stuff.
That doesn't explain the perp walk.
It kind of looked like him, but yeah. You know what? One of his jokes was always that about, you know, name anyone in power, and he would say, he'd chuckle and say, well, they owe me a favor. And you know what? Maybe that favor got cashed in. So.
So one of the things that you and I are concerned about is the confluence of influence between the state and like social media giants and the corporate press. And you and I were talking a bit about this, about, I had Robert Epstein, I forget his last name, I think it's Epstein, on the show. He's the guy behind the Creepy Line. And he made the point that, like, look, if Facebook just said reminders to vote to people who follow Hillary Clinton's page, but not Donald Trump's page, that's going to influence the election, and we'd have no way of knowing about this. But you and I were talking a bit about the influence of Chinese power in this space, and I wanted you to save it for the show so we could all discuss together. Can you talk a bit about that?
Sure. I mean, where to begin? Like, we know definitively that the executive levels of these companies, like the tech giants, have been infiltrated by, you know, Chinese state assets, if not double agents. I mean, at every level, you can say, like, remember, like, Roosevelt's State Department was like half Stalinist in the end, right? So there's a fair number of executive
positions. Interrupt you, just for people to be clear, because they might not know this. It's not just Americans who were favorable toward Russia. It's not just Americans who think China gets a bad rap. It's people who are reporting directly to these foreign countries. There's a very big difference.
That's right. And remember that California is itself its own enclave, especially in Silicon Valley and the centers of power, like, you know, around Mountain View and the Bay Area and stuff. So there's already like a higher Sino influence, or a better like admixture of direct Chinese stock in these domains, but also in these companies and demographically in these areas. And remember that the background radiation of these populations is Chinese dailies, regular propaganda, not just on newspapers, but in TV networks. It's a train.
Okay, that's no worries.
Yeah. It's kind of busy this time of day.
It's the comet. It's the comet.
Yeah.
We're here in Austin. There's a train.
And no one is on it.
Is that true?
One of these casualties of COVID. I mean, not that many people rode it to begin with.
Oh, it's like a commuter train or passenger train?
It's like our MTA or whatever. And nobody ever on these things. And of course, they got $100 million in PPP loans.
Because we need trains, yeah.
they're on the radio talking about expanding, building a tunnel downtown.
Yeah, it's sure, like, that makes sense. Yeah. You know,
perfect.
Okay, anyway, you're saying the Bay Area.
Yeah, it's almost too complex to really look at. But we have like flashpoints where Peter Thiel points out last year, you know what, I'd like the FBI to simply ask the leadership of Google, you know, show me that people, the Chinese government hasn't infiltrated your leadership, or prove to me that these aren't, you know, double agents. And that, I know that's tough to do, but just the accusation itself shows that, like, there's a blind spot. And these companies are so influential that, of course, they have strong ties, not just in business, but in politically and demographically to China. But this goes deeper. We know about a number of disclosed programs and programs in the open, like China's 1,000 Talents program, which is directly related to economic espionage in the United States. We know that in major government grant-making organizations across the federal government, in the last 2 years, it's been disclosed that there's barely any oversight on who gets the grants, why the grants are given. And I'm not saying that Chinese influence is there in the awarding, but I am saying that the researchers awarded the money aren't looked at for their connections to China. We know that Huawei is part of a civil military fusion program, and that kind of bubbled up into the mainstream. There's this general awareness that when China has the lead in 5G, they also have the lead in global surveillance.
Yeah.
There is a general awareness of this, but by and large, I would say it's some of China's influence, specifically in the academy, and thereby, like by contact, in elite cultural circles, that they can control a certain discourse about China by way of, you know, racial concern trolling or social justice concern trolling. And so, like, just at the beginning of the Wuhan flu, should we really talk about? I'll stop.
Hey guys, Michael Malice here. Want to tell you about Real Paper, R-E-E-L. Here's what's awesome about Real. It's 3-ply toilet paper delivered straight to your door. They're here to make sure you never run out of toilet paper ever again. Have you ever had that happen? I haven't. You have. You're disgusting. So it's soft, it's durable, and it's made entirely out of sustainable bamboo. Here's the bonus. If you go to realpaper.com, R-E-E-L paper.com, and use code WELCOME25, you get 25% off a purchase on your first subscription box and free shipping. That's not too shabby. It's 3-ply toilet paper made of bamboo, nice and soft. So your friends come over. Oh, what is this? Oh, you probably haven't heard of it. Oh, you have 2-ply at home, huh? I guess that would work for regular people. If you go to reelpaper.com, you get free shipping. You get 25% off a single purchase with the code WELCOME25. And for every roll of toilet paper you buy, they help people in need get access to clean toilets, something you wouldn't know about because your house is disgusting.
It's not this busy.
It's not a big deal.
Sometimes they're back-to-back like this. You know, China's efforts for the last year have been about not just denying where the flu came from or that it was their fault that they didn't handle it so well, but like casting aspersions in the right circles because they know it's a wedge issue in America, among other places, to accuse the Chinese of doing anything because we have this Achilles heel when it comes to racial conversations or ethnic conversations. But dude, I've gone off the reservation here. Your question was about like specific influence in social media. And look, we know there are certain wedge issues that China can exploit, like when it comes to our military. Like when you see the West Point graduating class talking about social justice and stuff, right. you can assume China is involved in that. When we see a New York Times piece talk about how like there's too much whiteness in the US Marine Corps, you can assume there's Chinese money behind that. It's just easy to do that. And of course there's lots of secondary sources and evidence that like, you know, buffet this conversation. But this is, again, like a blind spot for people. Or let's say the way we know China's exerted influence in Google specifically, to give you concrete examples. A bunch of social justice-y concern trolling led to a petition to make Google not contract with the Pentagon, right? Google should never be used to develop weapons of war, you know, or warfare tools, all right? Okay, you know what? And Google spikes its Pentagon contract. But Google and DeepMind worked with China. And of course, Google's AI lab is basically, you know, in China. And that means it's de facto a project of the People's Liberation Army as well. So we know that Google is building military technology for China and not for the United States in the specific domain of AI, for example. That was engineered.
How hopeful are you for the future of America and the world at large? So this is an argument you and I had about the white pill.
Yeah. Well, look, I feel better about the direction of things in the last few months simply because it feels like we've gotten through the fog of war related to this virus. It felt like every single civil liberty was just being, you know, deep sixed all at once.
People were cheering for more and more.
Yeah, it was crazy how rapid it was. And everybody, I think, had a sense of this speed, this velocity this summer of how quickly this wasn't America any longer. It does feel like there's not just a desire for normalcy, but like an active contempt about the city leaders who visited such despair upon the peoples of New York and LA, and then people are leaving, right? It's not just like, oh, we're miserable. No, they're actually voting with their feet. They're coming to Austin or they're coming to other places. And then there's an open conversation now in the mainstream media about the violence in the cities and the racial unrest, and not just racial unrest, but racialist unrest now as a component of BLM. You see like now BLM's upside down 20 points with white people. And
is
even
that
those,
right? 20? Wow.
Even those, well, from where they were in June.
Yeah, that's so, still a big deal.
Yeah, it's a negative 20, and that's numbers that are probably a month old themselves. So people are, I think, wise to what would otherwise be this passive, I don't know, dissent into South African conditions or like Brazilification. And I think that's what I worry about. Like, I don't think America as a state fails, but I do think America is at its limit of state capacity. Clearly, we blow a trillion every month now. I mean, that's wild. And then also,
There's no pushback.
No, I know.
Yeah.
Right.
That's like, the thing. There's no pushback whatsoever.
I don't think you had this conversation. It was like a lawyer who had this conversation with me this week, and he was like, "Well, my real choices this election are between the party that wants to spend $3 trillion next month or $2 trillion."
Yeah.
You know, and that's not good for the future of any country. But you know, modern monetary theory and everything has just changed the dimension of things. So I was just worried that if we kept everything to the level of we still somehow believe in the myth of American institutions, that we were really truly going to get a Biden-Harris presidency. At least that seems contested to me now. At least it seems the Senate will be, you know, there might probably be divided government in November. And I think divided government is the best thing to hope for the next 5-10 years.
One of the other things you and I were talking about, and you have a more informed but different perspective on this, is the future of gun rights in this country. That's obviously your core competency and what you've made your name on. I had said that I was very hopeful because there's an increased awareness and understanding among 2A people that there's not really a conversation to be had with the other side, that they would do everything in their power and gladly take everyone's guns away and now they stop pretending otherwise. You were talking about how there are these under the radar lawsuits that are coming up that people need to know about, and I hadn't heard of them. Can you talk about those for a bit?
Yeah, and you know what? You won't. On one level, like the latest lawsuit, this was last week, this is Friday. Every town and Lori Lightfoot of Chicago, the mayor of Chicago, the mayor of Syracuse, New York, and someplace in South Carolina, they banded together to sue the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms, which enforces the Gun Control Act and actually implements the regulations that determine what is and isn't a gun, you know, what is and isn't a machine gun, blah, blah, blah. And this is a very specific lawsuit brought in the Southern District of New York, you know, the sovereign district, one of the most corrupt districts in the country. And the reason that should smell at the beginning is if you're going to sue an agency of the federal government and you're already that close, I mean, this should have gone to the DC circuit, and it didn't. They put it in New York knowing that they're hoping to get the right person sympathetic to their argument, which is that the definition of a firearm has been illegally, let's say, derived by the department against statute, and it needs to be declared illegal. So it's kind of this, it's both a Hail Mary, it's desperate, it doesn't cite many authorities, but if it's unexamined, if the NRA and the NSSF don't jump on it, or if Maine Justice doesn't see it, basically there's this collusion between true believers in the ATF and activists like Everytown with Bloomberg money that know that they can just strike at the very regulatory definition of a firearm and eliminate what they see as this successful workaround to the post-Brady, I don't know, like inframing of gun rights, which has been Nick's checks, buying from an FFL, and closing the quote-unquote gun show boyfriend, blah, 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 loopholes. In fact, to these people, the entire Second Amendment is a loophole, and the best way to get at that is to strike at the definition of a receiver, a definition of a firearm, and to make it such that no one can really ever make a gun again. And they think they can get a judge just to declare the state of play since 2015 illegal, to start over again, and accept their own petition for rulemaking, which is pretty extensive.
It's not absurd that there is such a judge out there.
Oh, you know what? Even odds, they've got him because they're in the Southern District already. Now, I think there's lots of, look, we caught this last week. It's fine. I think Palmer 80 will intervene and everything will be fine on that one. But what you can see is like there's bills that mirror this language in the Senate right now, now they don't say this in this way, but the effect is it makes making your own firearm illegal, completely illegal. Right, there's been this reaction since COVID where they understand, whoa, wow, not only did 10 million people buy guns, but now a third of all the guns we're finding connected to crime in certain cities, if you believe the ATF, et cetera, are homemade. Uh-oh. Everyone suddenly figured out, you know what, I don't have to worry about the NICS check. I don't have to worry about the NFIB. I don't have to worry about the paperwork being filed on me when I buy too many handguns. And of course, states like California feel that they have closed on this process, and where very soon you'll be able to buy or sell, you know, one gun a month or something. There's this idea that they've enframed and enclosed, encapsulated the sites of the distribution of firearms, and that these commercial sites alone are completely steered and controlled, and they can squeeze and you know, like with the ammunition checks and stuff in California, they've economically determined that no new handguns get added to the registry. FFLs, it's just not worth it for them economically to process transactions. They can starve the entire enterprise commercially. And then, unfortunately, most Americans, once they've encountered that commercial or legal difficulty, have also discovered technology, which allows them to have whatever gun they want anyway. And so now they have to go much, much deeper and get to what the definition of a firearm is.
You were one of the first people to raise awareness, I hate that expression, but it's the correct one, of the influence of the credit card companies and how willing they are to affect change on a cultural level, maybe under the background. They're not tooting their own horn about this, but they're being very heavy-handed. An example that I came across in my life is I had bought a pen holder from a company, and the guy makes those handles for guns, right? Decorative handles. He does not sell guns at all. And they would not let him use Visa or MasterCard as their payment processor.
Yeah.
I know you had tried to do Patreon as an alternative to Patreon, which would allow people who Patreon found too radioactive.
Yeah.
And you had to shut down because you couldn't get Visa and MasterCard and the others to work with you. Can you talk a bit about that and what they're trying to do?
Yeah, I can talk about that. One, just the thought that we could do Patreon came from years of getting shut down anyway through our gun stuff with credit card companies, merchant processors, different banks. What you find is there's a kind of relative coterie of monopolies. The overall power of credit card issuing is in hands one of just like Visa, MasterCard, American Express. I mean, there's not much competition.
What about Discover? Everyone always forgets about Discover.
Discover is one of these, you know, they're trying.
Yeah.
And then there's other cards, and there's the PIN debit network and other things. And then there's actually been some reform post-2009 about PIN debit, for example. But, you know, if you want to buy anything, you're going to have a credit card. And Visa and MasterCard basically decide who lives and dies. They've been more involved in the social justice causes in the last, I'd say, 10 years. Than they had ever been before. Before that, it was all OFAC stuff, you know, fugitives from justice and people on designated watch lists, terrorists, that kind of stuff. And now they're participating through revised terms of service, which I think is an aspect not just of the culture war, but of our intelligence agencies and pressure from the Treasury Department. You know, Patreon's conclusion was not the first time we saw things like this. Like in 2013, I couldn't get approved by certain gun processors. Like 3D guns themselves were too toxic for banks. And then we saw certain personalities themselves become banned by MasterCard. You know, like if you studied too much about radical Islam or whatever, you suddenly find out your MasterCard can't be used. But these would be these isolated examples that never really accumulated into anything culturally. And then it was disclosed at the end of the Obama years that there was in fact an active measure from the federal government called Choke Point, Operation Choke Point. This was a set of regs that basically went out to all the banks who themselves are the merchant processors, adding way more scrutiny to their transactions related to firearms. So major banks like Chase and Bank of America basically stopped issuing new lines of credit to new gun businesses, and credit card processors stopped taking new FFLs and stuff. So there was even in 2010 to 2012, there was a freeze on who could even enter the market because basically people stopped taking new clients in that period. And then we began to see a new style of active, I don't know, cancellation after that period. So I've been canceled many, many times. Patreon itself was just for style points. I had two or three accounts, merchant IDs saved up, thought I'd use them. I got real quick. That company got TMF'd and I got TMF'd. And that's something that Gab, right? Andrew Torba, he's had to deal with. This guy, for example, that's just a social media website, right? It's supposedly about free speech.
Yeah.
Not even about right-wingers, but he's TMF'd. And when you're on the terminated merchant file, it's all your information. It's your social security number. It's all your previous addresses. It's all your associates, like through the credit bureaus and stuff. And so not only can he not get credit card processing or use his cards, his family can't, you know, related business associates and stuff. Like, so it's similar to what we see when we talk about the Chinese social scores and stuff. They're keeping score.
What possible workarounds are there in the future to mitigate their capacity to do this?
Of the credit card companies?
Yes.
I mean, you know, the obvious answer are alternative currencies like Bitcoin. But of course, we know these have limited adoption, especially in the mainstream and among like boomers who have, you know, income and expendable.
Yeah.
So the real thing is there have been companies who have developed bridges between credit card and Bitcoin and you know, like in the example of Backpage, for example, Backpage.com, you know, those guys, there's United States v. Lacey and United States v. Larkin right now. Those guys might be going away. Who knows? But they ended up getting in trouble, like half of their indictments for money laundering charges, because the credit card companies decided not to do business with them anymore, even though their businesses were legal. So they created shell companies and got merchant IDs through those companies and processed their credit cards that way. So it used to be that was an answer. Well, you know, create tertiary structures, get merchant IDs there, and then do contractual business of processing transactions that way. It doesn't really work that way now. So I would say the best thing to do now is to develop scalable technology in PIN debit, to develop neutral third-party platforms that sell equipment to be on other people's platforms. But of course, all of this activity is in concert. So like I used to sell ghost gunners on Amazon, for example. Do you think I can sell ghost gunners on Amazon anymore? Unfortunately, there's been this entire, you know, like monopolization of the available sites to advertise, sell, and display your stuff. And all of them have uniform policies related to firearms. The only answer I have is pursue banking and financial infrastructure from other countries.
Can you talk to us about where the technology is for ghost guns in 2020? And what are the big technological hurdles that you're working to solve in the future?
You know, in the 3D printing space, we haven't had the lead there for a long time. You know, for at least 6-7 years now, we've been kind of out of the active development of that, but we facilitated other people's development of it. From 2013 to 2018, we saw a lot of completely printed concepts because that was the enthusiasm. Liberator, right, was completely printed, and so people wanted to see how far they could take that idea. We saw pistols like the Wash Bear and the Songbird. And these are, in fact, Songbird pistols are the kind that you see like in these international busts, like in Australia and other places. And those are completely printed guns and they work. And so it should be concerning to those authorities, and it's refreshing to see them. But I would say the state of the art in printables is in frames and partially printed guns. So we see guns like Control Pew's Low Point pistol, which is basically like a joke on a high point. It's a printed high point frame. We see printed Glock frames, G19s, G17s, G26. And of course, the most popular 80% handguns right now are Glocks because of a company called Polymer 80. It's so simple to convert their polymer frames, which is a little bit of drilling, a little bit of milling, that you can also print those frames. So a number of guns that we see at crime scenes, not just abroad, but in North America, are related to Glocks. They're like hybrid partial builds with 3D printed lowers. So even if the adversary somehow redefines a firearm and you can no longer sell even partially completed frames, you can always print them. And there's no way to do anything about that. And so a lot of the active development is there because it's now socially and politically aware, where for maybe 5 years after us, it stayed in this kind of hobbyist domain and didn't really take on the political dimension that I wanted it to. I guess I would say it has that dimension now. So that's in printed. I would say like everything else is, you know, the people are working on a Scorpion 80% frame. There's companies making active steps right now to develop new 80%s. Like the 80% market is hot. Most of the guns you hear about that are DIY or so-called ghost guns, they're made from 80%. So they're AR pistols or, you know, they're budget AR types, or they're 1911s or Glock frames. And those can be done on Ghost Gunner, or those can be done with a number of other tools.
I know my answer, but I really want to hear your answer to this question. What is your reaction to people who say things like, the founding fathers never expected technology to be what it is today, so the Second Amendment doesn't apply, and they wanted a well-regulated militia, so that means heavily regulated as to who gets guns?
Yeah, it's so funny. You know, regulated as a word took on this aspect that we give it only in like the 20th century. You know, it's very clear from textual and originalist examples and sources that well-regulated meant for the purposes of maintaining a free state, we need to regularly practice and muster, you know, to have the skills that a militia would have. But I don't intend to have a linguistic debate about it. It's just obvious through different drafts of the Second Amendment, and that the Second Amendment as a feature of Republican, you know, radical political discourse was all about how the people could maintain access to military-grade arms. There's not a good faith argument here.
Right, because the thing I always point out recently is like no militia goes hunting or to the range. The point of a militia is fighting the government.
Like the Stevens argument, right? This is the Second Amendment as a superfluous article. Why should the government give the people the freedom for the government to have, you know, the monopoly on violence? It makes no sense. It goes without saying. Of course. The government and the professional or whatever volunteer military would give itself the right to use its weapons in aggression and maintaining order. So No, clearly the Second Amendment by context, both structurally as a part of the Bill of Rights, following the First Amendment, et cetera, is meant to be, like, it's intended to be an offering of freedom or liberty to the people themselves, absent the structure of the federal government. I don't care if we agree or disagree about that. You know, that's a historical argument. It kind of doesn't matter now. The truth of the matter is that it's never been easier to make a gun. It's never been easier to buy a gun. And even in this conversation about ghost guns, where everyone's kind of fear-mongering and concern trolling, we have to remember that even now, in just the last 5 years, ATF estimated that almost 2 million firearms were stolen, or taken from vehicles, and something like 40,000 were just stolen straight up from gun dealers themselves. So there's a huge liquid market in stolen firearms. It doesn't matter that the founding fathers couldn't anticipate, let's say, 3D printing of a frame. But it does matter that there are Thomas Jefferson quotes on this, for example, that it's the great industrial pastime of the American people to make arms, that this is a huge source of income for early Americans, right? People who were not just frontiersmen, but were active exporters of their technology. They would work in barns, and of course, all the original, like a Liflet Remington, for example, great American names in firearms were just men in their barns turning out rifle barrels and starting to sell stuff, not just to the government, but to people. It's part and parcel of being an American identity, that not only can you keep and bear arms, but you can make them.
I am really, really excited because I wonder if the answer to this question is no. And if it is no, I get to tell you who this person is. Are you familiar with Louis Ling?
I don't think so. What are you going to tell me?
This is a great, great moment. Do you know about the Haymarket Martyrs?
Yes, I know the name. Yeah.
So there was, for people who don't know, there was a labor meeting in Haymarket in late 1900s, late 1800s, excuse me. Someone threw a bomb. They still don't know who. Cop blew up. Lots of people got killed. They arrested a bunch of people who were anarchists at the time, several of whom weren't even there by everyone's admission.
Yeah.
And charged them with murder, and saying, "Well, basically, you guys were responsible because you were promoting this violent ideology, so therefore you're directly responsible for this murder," and they were sentenced to hang.
Wow.
Louis Ling was one of them, and his attorney, they found dynamite at his house, and the quote becomes from him, which is kind of historically inaccurate: "I couldn't have thrown that bomb, I was at home making bombs." And his attorney on the record said, "Well, he's an American citizen. Why does he have dynamite? All this dynamite in his house." He goes, "He's an American citizen. He has a right to have dynamite in his house." Yeah. Like, that was the defense argument. It didn't fly.
Yeah.
But what was even fascinating about him is he got sentenced to hang. Somehow they smuggled in a blasting cap. He blew off his jaw and wrote in blood on his cell wall, "Hooray for anarchy," and died in prison before he was hung by the state.
Amazing.
And he told the cops, he said, "If you bring pistols, we will bring dynamite."
I love 19th century anarchism.
And he's,
which is true bomb throwing anarchism.
It was absolute bomb throwing anarchism. He's like, "Let me tell this court,
yes,
I am absolutely for force."
Yeah. You know, it's weird that has passed out of fashion as a form of, let's say, civil disobedience or, I don't know, riot making or something. Even up until the 70s, people were throwing bombs into crowds.
Well, do you know what they called it? The propaganda of the deed.
Of the deed, sure. That's from back in the
day. So Johann Most wrote a book called The Science of Revolutionary Warfare, which is about how to make dynamite in your own house.
Yeah.
And then 100 years later, have you ever read the updated version, which is the Anarchist Handbook? Cookbook, excuse me.
Of course, yeah.
Yeah, so that then this was a huge thing. About
full of recipes, which like kind of work.
It kind
maybe
of
didn't work.
And then you blow up a townhouse in the village.
I think the reliable companion from that period is like the Warsaw Pact guides from like the 70s and stuff. You know, it's like a black woman with an afro on the front, and like we're using kind of Soviet methods for basically like spoiling infrastructure. But I think it's interesting that, you know, the most we're seeing in the streets right now are people shooting fireworks and just kind of being nuisances, which, you know, it's got all the sound and bluster of that period, but it's like, do these people not mean it? Are they not truly revolutionaries? Why aren't they throwing bombs? And I'm not suggesting that they should, but I do think it's interesting that even the students of the SDS days in the 70s, right, they knew to throw a bomb in a window and they would blow themselves up.
Oh, yeah.
You know, it's, I think...
The weathermen.
I think, exactly, yeah, the Weather Underground. It's like protesting itself follows a certain pattern of meme craft where, you know, like we had spree shooting for a while before they canceled schools. So everyone wants to spree shoot now rather than throw bombs around. I don't know how to explain it other than there's a less physically aggressive or vitalistic, desire to throw everything away. the Soviets used to say there were two types of protests, you know, like, or let's say two types of riots. There were riots based on, you know, need and despair. And then there were riots based on decadence.
Oh, yeah.
And I think we have the second kind.
Yeah. The problem, one of the problems I think with capitalism is that once you take care of Maslow's hierarchy of needs at a very cheap cost, the human mind is still going to look for problems to solve because it's not going to sit there and be comfortable being complacent. And if there aren't any problems, it's going to find them. And that's what the root of much of anxiety comes from. It's like you can't just sit around like being content.
Yeah, the problem of having too much.
Yeah.
And nothing to do.
What is your answer to the people who say, look, what you're doing is empowering some very evil people. You're going to have people who come and shoot up the schools, you know, and all this other stuff. There's plenty of people who you would agree should never have guns. And you're basically letting them do this.
Well, you know, I'm not Facebook. And so far as I am a publisher, I'm a neutral third-party publisher. For me to control who has access to some of that material in the way that they want is not just discriminatory, but violates the protections of publishers in this country. So it treats the information differently, which is what they want. They don't want it to be considered protected by the First Amendment. And so I'm about, you know, expanding those First Amendment protections for this material, because I believe it. You know, why do we think it's First Amendment protected? Because it's so opposed, and because people have those kinds of things to say about it, that certain people shouldn't have access to it. That's how you know that the information is worth preserving. But number two, there is, like I've always said, like these are actually empirical questions. I mean, have people shot up schools with these guns? And then what does it tell you that they haven't? Will there be certain trade-offs at a certain point where do we find more of these guns homemade than not? I don't know. But the point is, at least for me, like that my enthusiasm rests on this overdetermined political enterprise of constantly, like, you know, by 1,000 cuts, killing the organic, I don't know, like the cultural organism of the Second Amendment in the United States. That's really a fruitless exercise now, because there's just this giant hole in the bag. And honestly, if they get what they want, this is what's kind of funny. I don't know why I'm fighting it so hard, but if they really get what they want and you can't do anything but buy a gun in this country anymore legally, well, then the homemade gun market is completely ours. And now you'll have more of the problem that you say you're trying to fight against. If you can't leave well enough alone, you know, if you can let things be frictionless enough in the regulated space, you don't have to worry about my space.
Yeah. It's like, oh, well, just, okay, I'll just make gin in my bathtub. You know what I mean? And then everyone's an alcoholic.
Yeah. Then we have real problems.
Yeah.
So it's like pick your poison. Right, to use your example, and the leftists, they only know how to overplay their hand. This is why I recently won in the Fifth Circuit against the Attorney General of New Jersey, because he called a press conference and said, "I'm going to stop Cody Wilson, name you by name."
He said, "Did he really?
I'm going to stop his supporters. This isn't about New Jersey. This is about, you know, we're going to be the, you know, if the federal government's not going to act, we're going to act, and we're going to regulate the internet."
Wait, when you saw this guy talking and mentioned your name, I don't know who he is, but did he come off like basically like straight out of an Ayn Rand novel?
Oh, I don't know. Kind of. I mean, he's a bit multiculty. This is that Sikh attorney general in New
Jersey. Yeah,
Graywall. And, you know, it's kind of ridiculous for him to parade around in his costume like that. But I don't know. It's of the time. So, you know, he has an American accent. He was raised here or whatever. So I don't feel the same kind of like Ayn Rand villainy.
Yeah, I got you. Yeah.
But he's a certain political opportunist, and he has just decided. Like, he understands that he can do as much as he wants to monkey around with the Second Amendment, and the Supreme Court won't really check him. They just proved that in a Graywall case that they denied cert on recently. And so these people get bigger than their britches, and they think they can start telling people in other states what to do. And, you know, it's worth.
Yeah, how is he going to take you down? You're not a New Jersey resident or citizen.
It doesn't matter. Doesn't matter. The law of nuisance in New Jersey, for example, they end up passing a statute. This is in 2018 in November. And that statute said if anyone in New Jersey can access this content, like the 3D files, right, from your website, well, then you're a criminal under our law for letting them do that.
Okay.
See, it's completely shifting. And of course, like I said with the sex stuff earlier, what's the word? Strict liability.
Yeah.
It's strict liability. It doesn't matter that I don't want people from New Jersey to do it, or I have no specific intent about it, or I even take measures to stop people from New Jersey downloading this stuff. If it happens, if one of the people in their civil division, you know, like gets the file, now I'm a felon in New Jersey. And that's what they want. They want to shut down speech on the internet that way. And they don't just leave it at that, as this website, or not this website, as this decision in the Fifth Circuit showed. They went to our hosting providers in California and tried to get them to pull on our side. I mean, they'll take every single step they can to affect reality. And I think, like I was telling you earlier, it's part of that Stacey Abrams dimension of democratic governance. To be invested with any amount of state power, doesn't matter how local, expands to as global as they can make it.
How close did they come to pulling down your website?
Well, I would say in large part they succeeded. I had to bring DefCad down for almost 2 years. And this was after I was busted and brought back to the U.S. So there was this whole period where, you know, we settled this thing with the State Department, but then all these different state governments tried to pull me into their own courts, Washington State, New Jersey, and Pennsylvania, sued me directly in federal court. And each of them wanted that pound of flesh. Each of them wanted to say, under our specific state laws, you know, this is illegal and this website has to be shut down. Graywall brought me into fucking chancery court in Newark and tried to get a chancery judge to shut down the website. I mean, they don't care. Principles of common law. I mean, this is why it's somewhat of an insult to have a turbaned, you know, second generation Sikh tell you things about your common law. It's like, well, no, buddy, like you haven't assimilated. You know what I mean? Right. A chancery judge in New York doesn't get to, or in New Jersey doesn't get to tell me in Texas what to do with a website on the internet. But they don't care.
Hey guys, Michael Malice here. I want to tell you about a very different kind of sponsor we have for this episode. It's called the Jordan Harbinger Show. It's a podcast you really should be listening to. Everyone will tell you, oh, you just got to listen to some podcast. You nod and say sure, and you never listen to it. Don't let that happen here. It's much better than some very failed podcast that I don't want to mention. Apple named it one of its best of 2018, and it's aimed at making you a better informed, more critical thinker so you can get a sense of how the world actually works. Every episode is a conversation with different guests. One week, he's talking to a hostage negotiator from the FBI. Another week, he's talking to a cinematographer who discovered a lost city in the jungle and made a huge archaeological find. I think that's pretty cool stuff. If you search for the Jordan Harbinger Show, H-A-R-B as in boy, I-N as in Nancy, G-E-R, and Apple Podcasts, Spotify, wherever you listen to podcasts, you will get a peek of something that will make your life a little bit better. Jordan Harbinger Show, go check it out.
Yeah. Do you think that there is an increased awareness among gun right advocates of the nature of the enemy?
Yes. I do think Beto O'Rourke helped advance the conversation because, sickeningly, in the entire second term of Obama, the liberal refrain was, no one's talking about taking away your gun.
You're a loon.
Do you remember this?
It's a conspiracy theory. Take off your tinfoil hat. We
no
just
one's
want gun safety.
It. We're not even talking about
right.
it.
Right. Like, so you're hearing things we're not saying, and you're a paranoid idiot, and right. we're not even going to bother talking to you. Let's have the adults have a conversation.
Exactly. And thankfully, we've moved past that. Now we are talking about taking the guns, and Beto O'Rourke can put a fine point on it. Hell yes, we're going to take away your AR-15. So,
well, it stands for Alt-Right 15.
that's right. That was real reporting. it reminds me of like the things that Mulbug told the New York Times about like naked bodybuilders.
Yeah,
flash dancing.
Yeah, BAP is the head of the New Right.
Yeah. Great stuff. So yeah, I do think the state of the conversation has advanced, and we recognize also like the influence exerted, which was like, I don't, why did the American gun control movement have such peripheral influence after the 90s and the Brady period? You know, in the expiration of the assault weapons ban, it was because like Bloomberg specifically hadn't decided to just put all this money behind it. There isn't actually a huge grassroots effort to support any of this stuff at the federal level. But now there's billionaire money involved. There's, you know, there's Soros, there's Bloomberg, and these groups are well financed and have good, let's say, ground games, right? Like they now surpass the NRA in their organization. The NRA, of course, shot its own foot, you know, and is now in decay in New York and stuff. But I would say, like, if you look to California, if you look to Connecticut, New Jersey, New York, we've got advanced state levels of gun control, which now the progressives have a taste for and feel like, well, the only way we'll really have the successful implementation of what we desire is at the federal level to perfect these schemes. And that's now agreed upon in every circle. You know, the New York Times took out that kind of that rare 100-year front page editorial. And this was, I think, 2017, maybe 2018 after Parkland, saying, yeah, we don't care. It's time to cabin the Second Amendment.
Yeah.
So this is, there you go. There's your masthead publication telling you the Second Amendment's over, and it's just a matter of when we get the right people in power.
And then you're the guy who's like, oh, cool, you could take away the Second Amendment. We'll still have our guns. Let's make that deal. You take the amendment, but you're not taking our guns.
Honestly, there really is this kind of come and take it attitude about it. And I know they put me through hell. They put other people through hell with this stuff. I mean, I'm getting sued constantly, and I don't know how much longer a little company like mine can take it. But there's such enthusiasm and such desire for our products that even when I lose credit card processors, for example, I mean, I lost American Express in February and my sales went up 30% during COVID. You know what I mean? There's people who are avowed Democrats and I'm sure will still vote for Biden that bought 5 handguns this summer.
Yeah, of course.
You know what I mean?
That's a no-brainer.
It's its own kind of pull, and there's not going to stop being demand for these implements. And unfortunately for our adversary, I would say, to make it harder for the commercial providers to provide only gives it over to me.
Yeah, I've said many times, and I'm certain you agree, that the best argument against gun control is gun proliferation.
Yeah, that makes sense. I think that's right. And you know what? I hate to say just kind of obvious things, but I have never seen sales like we've seen right now. It's true what they said about the Trump slump. People kind of just assumed in the first 2 years of the Trump presidency there'd be, you know, universal concealed carry reciprocity and that kind of stuff. You know, that people were talking about legalizing silencers. And so the gun industry really faded, and a lot of the AR budget suppliers went out of the market, and we thought we'd seen the kind of top of everything. But with this unrest and with the fact that Trump, you know, probably won't win again, this is ferocious demand like I've never seen before.
What is it that you guys actually sell and produce, and what is it that you don't sell and produce? Because there's a lot of, I think, intentional obfuscation of what your organization does.
I wouldn't agree with that, but it's difficult to stay on message because we're always known for the 3D stuff.
Okay.
And so and I lead, you know, discursively with the 3D stuff because that's like where I'm excited. But kind of like with Apple and the iPhone, right? Like Apple's, most of its profits are the iPhone sales. Defense Distributed sells the Ghost Gunner. The Ghost Gunner is a CNC machine. It's a platform.
What's CNC stand for?
Computer Numeric Control.
Okay.
It's a form of milling. It's related to 3D printing in that they both rely on the same type of, you could say, like numerical control language. In our case, gerbil is the language you use. So it's programmable machining. So I can take a metal blank, you know, this is somewhat representative, this is my bottle opener. ATF says when it looks like this and it doesn't have the fire control pocket or these holes milled out, that this isn't a gun, you know, or it's not a receiver of a gun. And if you do a little bit of CNC milling on it, it suddenly becomes one. And so because there's a big liquid interstate market of those components, even since the late 2000s, people were just doing those with drill presses and common hand tools and stuff, and it was taking a while. All we did was automate that process and put it in an affordable package, and then add a certain level of, let's say, like open control. You can program it now to not just do that. It's not just on rails for ARs. You can do other handguns. You can do whatever you want. You can engrave. You can skeletonize. And suddenly people are getting back into the business like I was telling you about. It's suddenly easier to become an FFL again. It's suddenly easier to find certain economies of scale, customization. And so it's a profit center for this business. And it plays into the community that we've been developing anyway. So I'm not actively developing engraving or skeletonization code, but I know people in my community are. So it's like the Red Hat model of Linux development. I develop the platform and the core software, and then other people can live in that ecosystem and develop out in their own direction.
What are your thoughts on this recent lawsuit in the state of New York by the New York Attorney General against NRA and Wayne LaPierre specifically? As soon as this went out, there were a slew of NPCs saying this has nothing to do with the Second Amendment, using those words. And I took a screen cap, I made a collage. There were like 30 of them saying the exact same thing verbatim. Yeah, yeah, yeah. And I said, the good thing is to realize we don't have a lot of opponents. It's one mind in many bodies.
Yeah, the distributed consensus.
Yeah.
Look, honestly, it's probably a pretty good case under New York law. Some elements of it are probably pretty good. I do think there's evidence of financial mismanagement at NRA, which should surprise no one.
Right. You have no particular love for that organization.
No, but neither do I want them to pass. Like, sure. I'm not going to sit here and act like, we don't need the NRA. I mean, obviously, they were great for a long time. They were a great standard bearer. And despite their faults and everything that they've done to deliver gun control to us, they were important in 2013 for defeating universal background checks and any of the other Senate bills that people were proposing, like the Feinstein bills of the second Obama term. So I hate to see them go, but I do think they're in passing now, and I think they're falling, and I think they should be pushed. And I hope New York has a little bit of success. That said, the entire ecosystem that supported the NRA is a large organization. Like, we have this conversation about credit card processing. Yeah. Well, NRA's advertising and insurance firms had already pulled the rug out from them anyway. There's not the support anymore among the classic institutions for an organization as big as NRA on this issue anymore. Like, the Second Amendment as like an aspect of mainstream political culture is in passing.
Who do you think is a bigger threat to gun rights? The New York Times or the Democratic Party?
I'm going to wait for this train to pass.
Sure.
Sometimes you just hear one, but... what a strange thing. So do you have an opinion about the difference between the two? Isn't one just the Pravda of the other, you know?
Well, I have an opinion.
Look, I guess it's a false choice. If I have to make the choice and put money on it, it's the Democrat Party, because it's a real organ of power with real people that know and make decisions based on where they think they can consolidate power. Whereas the New York Times is increasingly like a caricature of itself with, you know, Columbia law grads and stuff just trying to kind of imitate or reproduce what is already the agreed upon, you know, consensus political message.
So you're more bearish on the Democratic Party, more bullish on the Times in terms of influence in 10 years?
Yeah, only because of conversations like bio-Leninism and stuff. Yeah. I think the Democrat Party stands a chance of truly consolidating power in this country in the next 10 years. Before it has its own internal division or whatever. I do think it's possible that the Democrat Party will become the national party, you know, like it was.
It was for a long time.
Like,
yeah,
it was before. And every trend would tend to support this. Like, we can't count on Republican outliers somehow defeating by the Electoral College the popular vote every 4 years.
Yeah, yeah.
It's just not going to happen. So that's the way I think about it.
Cody, we're running out of time. Yeah. What has been your favorite part of this interview?
The intimacy that we've developed together here.
You are welcome.